God, please, Lord, just bring us into this place, God, with open hearts unto you, Lord. Just open up our minds, our heart, God. Please, Lord, let this service inspire somebody that's willing and wanting to go further to you, Lord. We praise you, God. We worship you, God. In Jesus' name, amen.
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 Thank you.
Without you, I need you. I need you. Everybody single.
Oh, oh, oh.
Well, it's good to see you guys this morning. And the next part, I met this young lady about a year ago, and it's just been a blessing and an honor to see her grow in the Lord. And I'm glad that she has a heart for God, and I'm glad that she wants to grow more and learn more of Him so she can have that closer relationship with God. And it just happens that her birthday is tomorrow. She'll be turning 21. I'm sure she'll turn up for the Lord. But the person I want to introduce you guys is Lynette Jackson.
Good morning, everybody. I just want to take time to just thank God for just waking me up this morning and just for being here. I was gonna give a quick testimony. When I first came to Eastern, I really wasn't focused on God. I was focused on other things, like going out and try to be somebody that I'm not. And when I came to Acts, I met Jefton in one of my English classes, my sophomore year or freshman year, in Miss Preston's class. And he told me about Acts, and when I came here, I learned more about myself and who I wanted to be. And as I was coming to X, I was running from God. I wasn't putting my trust in Him as I should have. And there's a scripture that came to me, and it is from Psalm 7. If you have your Bibles, you can turn to Psalm 7. I'll wait till everybody has their pages ready. You can say amen when you have it. Okay, and in Psalm 7 it says, O Lord my God, in thee do I put my trust. Save me from all them that persecute me and deliver me, lest he tear my soul like a lion and rendering it in pieces, there is still none to deliver. So basically, in that scripture, it spoke to me that I can't keep running from God. I can't keep letting people or words or anybody in the world define who I am. Because God, before I even took my first breath, God knew who I was. He knew where I was going to end up. He knew I was going to end up here up here at Eastern. And this year, I lost my aunt. And it was very hard because I was putting her before God, because when I needed help, that was the person who I turned to. And when she died, I felt empty. I felt like I had nobody. I had nobody to turn to but God. And when I saw her in the casket that day, it made me realize that God took her away not that he was angry, it's just that he wanted me to focus on him and of him. And when she was gone, I was afraid. I was afraid because I had nobody and I had nowhere to turn. But when it happened, I called my Axe family, Kiana and a couple other people from Axe. They came to console me. And when I had that, I found that God and Axe is just, if you have Axe, just be around Axe. They just bring so much love and peace to you. Like, I love them with all my heart. Yesterday, they surprised me on my birthday with cupcakes, and I cried because I felt as I had nobody. I felt empty. I felt my vessel was empty. And there's a last scripture I want to talk about. It's in 2 Timothy 1, chapter 1, verse 7. Richard Gary told me about it earlier. Say amen when you have it. Verse 7, it says, "For God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but the power of love and of sound mind." So God gave us the mind and the spirit to do what we please, but make sure we're pleasing him first. So on my 21st birthday, I realized that, you know, we're supposed to go out and have fun and do this and do that. And I realized that I don't need those things. I don't need people defining me or telling me who I am anymore, because I know who I am, because God knows who I am. He knows who I am. I'm a child of a one true king. So we just have to realize that God is love, and we have nobody. That's the person who we need to turn to. So keep your eyes on God and just have that spirit of just wisdom. Just pray for wisdom and strength. And then just pray for my strength in the Lord. God bless you.
All right. I have the pleasure to introduce a group of young men that come here to Axe and have started doing some music. I actually got the pleasure to be able to work with them a little bit. I would like to introduce to you guys, Bosses, Brothers of Saved Souls and Encouraging Sisters.
Woo! Did it again. How y'all doing? I said, how y'all doing? Y'all blessed? Y'all excited? Well, give it a hand. Give God a hand clap then if y'all excited.
Amen.
Hey, I've been hearing a whole bunch of slang out here lately, and one thing that's been stuck to me on this whole day, and I don't know, and you know, God turns everything bad good. He put this one thing in me. It was like, turn down for what? And a lot of people, when they talk about that, they be talking about, I don't know, maybe drugs, drinking, smoke, or whatever. But when we in the house of God, turn down for what? We turning up for God to the fullest. We going to the maximum on this thing.
To the maximum.
And I'm just so excited to be here with you all. And, you know, we're going to have some fun today. We're going to have some fun today. So our first track is entitled No Shame. How many of y'all have ever felt like you had to hide God? You know, you didn't want to talk about it with some of y'all friends. Y'all were scared sometimes. You got some people that you just feel wouldn't take it right there, make fun of you for loving God. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, today we finna be out here with no shame. We just,
no
you
shame.
Know, so everybody stand
no
on your
no
feet
shame.
Right now.
No shame in the game. Come on.
Let's
no
go.
Look us up, we yeah. got no shame.
Woo.
If you ain't got no shame, feel free to sing with us, dance with us, move with us.
Oh, I'm going to dance.
There's no shame in the building. No shame.
Let's get it.
Woo. Hey, turn no it shame. Up a little louder.
Let's get it.
Let's go. Woo. Let's go.
Let's go. Turn that up right. a little bit.
Let's get it.
No shame, boy. I don't know where to begin. I don't know how to describe it. His love never ends. Unconditional love. You make me feel brand new. You heal my heart when it's broken. Where would I be without you? Unconditional love.
Come on, go in there and put a song. I'm excited, y'all.
Woo. No shame.
Come on, let's get it, y'all. Come on. Uh-huh. Look. Listen. When I was down in cold pits, the Lord was in the midst. But I ain't high since. When I was there trying to jump the fence. Ever since I hit high school, wanted to be cool. I saw them dudes that used to roll. I never liked them dudes living in the hood. Never understood what we came and could do. Cause all of the kids never followed the rules. Even from the corner store, running from the law at 13. And I was right there trying to find a way to succeed. I see my first homie bleed. It's smoke trees and then the devil tried to reach his hand at me. Cause I wasn't young. Ethical child, everyone else is running around, but my mother kept me in the church. I couldn't rely on that relationship. The Lord kept me informed to be a leader, never conform. The devil comes in different shapes and forms, but with you, I see the brighter light. I give all of the glory to you. You're in the light.
The
light
is the glory to you. He will always be true. Whatever the time is made, he will make everything a chance to
be. Hey!
Son be my only one, but first things first, I die for the Lord. Shout out to reconcile, the Bible is my sword. Frontline general, my target is aim. My guy's impregnable, death is certain, but God's wrath is inevitable. I mean, it's about the federals, paranoid on the regular. Invested in this sin who took my money like a treasure. You feeling better, bro, I certainly hope so. This shoot to get me more slow. Modern music, I chose to let my flesh go. I die, bro. So what you claim, you shooters? Boy, you really Judas. God, he been the ruler, got killed like Martin Luther. Resurrected, my God, he'll reign forever. Be the proof of his cross is tatted on you, but bro, you cannot fool us. Let your light shine, show love. With this truth, he's the divine. It's not in vain if you serve Christ. He is lying.
No matter what you do, oh, he will always get you through. Whatever the time of day, he will make everything a good thing.
Hey! Making moves with the Lord, coming from the bottom to the top of the problem without the Gomorrah and Sodom. If I were put a court, I would have to exhort on Jesus' this good report. I was coming short, I was playing sports, no remorse for my brutal force. Taking this foolish course, I could learn to go to my source. No time to be punking out, had to function with no doubt. Walking this righteous route with my Father, we hitting out. Correction, we showing out through the Spirit, we going out. Now why would you want to pout what you've already won about? That's how I thought time to time, but the battle was in my mind. Had to get on my grind, living life without getting fined. Praising God for his guidance, through grace I be steady fighting. Through grace I be steady riding, rejoicing and steady vibing. He got my life right, and I be taking my next flight in the sky with my Jesus, and we ain't taking no kites.
No matter what you go through, yeah, taking all that right you get to do. Whatever the time of day, he will make everything you take to live for Christ.
Hey!
Oh, yeah,
Come on.
Know what you really wanna do. You wanna live for Christ. Woo. Woo. Live for Christ. Come on. Woo.
Give out a hand clap. Hey, while y'all still standing up, we're going to go straight into the meet and greet. So go on ahead and greet your neighbors. We finna go on ahead and show everybody love on this day. Give God some praise and meet and greet your neighbors right now. Woo.
Doing today? God's good, isn't he? I'm here to introduce somebody who's very special to me. Let you guys know, my name is Ron Akmensa. I go to Northern Illinois University. Every time I come to this church, you know, I feel uplifted, happy, joyful. You know, I just love seeing college students coming together, just worshiping God. That's just something that's really special to me. I just love seeing that. This person that I'm going to introduce, I've known since I was in high school. My sophomore year, someone who's very positive and is has God's spirit, and he's worked through her to get to me to really make me the man that I am today. And looking at her right now, she just makes me so happy, guys. I know she's gonna really make you guys feel uplifted, and she's gonna talk a little bit. Phyllis from Pond.
Hallelujah. Thank you. Well, I first want to give an honor to God, who's definitely the head of my life, and to Pastor Mon K for giving me this awesome opportunity. A couple weeks back, Pastor came to me and he said, "You're graduating, aren't you?" And I said, "Mm-hmm." And he said, "You haven't been up here before, have you?" And I said, "Mm-mm." But, you know, I'm glad that I said yes, because God really was working through him. I mean, I come to church every day and I'm always kind of in the backgrounds, but God really has been speaking to me, and I think he really has prepared this message not only for me to understand and hear, but for you guys to understand and hear as well. So go ahead and get started. This message is called The Parable of the Sower, and it's taken from Luke chapter 8, verse 4 through 8, so you guys can go ahead and turn to there. Say amen when you got it. All right, so I'm going to go ahead and read Luke chapter 8, 4 through 8. This is, well, the part that I'm reading is from NIV, so. While a large crowd was gathering and people were coming to Jesus from town after town, he told this parable. A farmer went out to sow his seed. He was scattering the seed. So as he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path. It was trampled on, and the birds ate it up. Some fell on the rocky ground. When it came up, the plants withered because they had no moisture. Other seeds fell among thorns, which grew up with it and choked the plants. Still, other seeds fell on good soil. It came up and yielded a crop, 100 times more than was sown. When he said this, he called out, "Whoever has ears to hear, let him hear." In the next verse, Jesus explains how the word of God is the seed. And he goes on and he talks about the four different ways we receive the word when we hear it. He speaks about the indifferent hearer, the emotional hearer, the worldly hearer, and the receptive hearer. the first time I heard this message, I couldn't like help but think of what kind of hearer am I? Because you know, you hear the word and you know it's preached in church and you go to Bible studies and you hear it. And even when you're in your quiet time reading the Bible, you know, how do you really receive the word and how do you retain it? So he goes on, and in Luke chapter 8, verse 12, it reads, those who fell on the path are the ones who hear, and then the devil comes and takes away the word from their hearts, so that they may not believe and be saved. The seeds that fall on the wayside are referred to as indifferent hearers. These are people who, they hear the word, but they're kind of like the people who, they know that there is a God, but they believe and they've set in their hearts that there is no God. They walk as though there is no higher being and that they're kind of just in control of their life. I think we all know someone that's like that. These are people who live as if there's no judgment day, kind of like free for all. And then in the next verse, Jesus talks about those that fall on rocky ground. These are people referred to as emotional hearers. In Luke chapter 8, verse 13, it reads, "Those on rocky ground are the ones who receive the word with joy. When they hear it, but they have no root. They believe for a while, but then in the time of testing, they fall away." This is definitely where I fell for a long period of time in my life. I'm trying not to cry. You know, I've always grown up in the church, and I've always just been, you know, just, I guess, engulfed with Christians and just always been around godly people. I teach praise dance at the church back at home. I'm one of the youth leaders at my church back at home. I'm in a Christian sorority here. I'm head of the ushering ministry. So I definitely love God, and I truly love him with everything that's within me. And I was riding full force in the back seat of his vehicle. And one day he took a quick stop. And on my will, I decided to step out of the car. And I stepped out and I looked at my surroundings and I was blinded by what I saw. I wanted so badly to be accepted by people around me. And I even, you know, tried to rekindle friendships that God like dismantled for reasons. In my time of trial, I was tested on how strong I would stand when others put me down for trying to live a Christian life. You know, they labeled me as church girl or goody two shoes, you know, you're fake, or you know, you're a church girl. Like, there's no way. What are you gonna talk about? God and church, you have nothing else to talk about. And it really, really hurt me. You know, I was talking to a friend, a long friend, and this person told me that, you know, I wanted to go out with them. I was like, yeah, let's go out, trying to live in the world. And she was like, Phyllis, you're the type of girl I take to a banquet, not an after set. And I was just like, what? But, you know, it really hurt me. And I deeply failed because I went into depression trying so hard to morph into what they wanted to see me as and not who God had molded me and ordained me to be. And I thank God for Ron, because one day I was like crying on the phone with him and I was just like, I have no friends and I'm just always in my room depressed and nothing, you know, I have nothing to do. And he said, Phyllis, why don't you read Matthew 5? And I'm like, what? I'm crying right now. but I did. And in Matthew 5:5, it reads, "Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth." Matthew 5:10, "Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for the kingdom of heaven is with them." Matthew 5:11 through 12. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven, for the same way they persecuted prophets who were before you. And as I kept reading Matthew, I couldn't help but say thank you, God, for revealing this to me, because he showed me that he had called me to greater, and that, you know, it didn't matter what was outside around me. He was sheltering me because he wanted me to live the life that he had ordained me to live. And I'm not going to take any more outsides and look around me or, you know, look for the world for direction. I'm definitely going to stay focused on God, because that's where I need to be. So, which brings me to the third type of peer, the thorns. These are people who we refer to as worldly hearers. Luke chapter 8:14 reads, "The seed that fell on thorns stands for those who hear, but as they go on their way, they are choked with life's worries, riches, and pleasures, and they do not mature." Worldly hearers are people who get choked up by life's worries, riches, and pleasures, and they don't really mature in Christ. So for example, I'm sorry, I'm like getting all sad. For example, you know, you go to church and you start to really realize that I like church. You know, you come every Sunday, you even start tithing. And this is definitely something that you know that God is really, he's doing something in your life, you know? You know that feeling you get? And then he blesses you with a job that you've just been praying for. And you're like, yes, thank you, God. And then you get happy, you love your job, you even get a raise and you get, you know, a promotion. And you're like, life is good right now. But then you start to put God on the back burner. You know, you stop coming to church regularly and you don't make tithing a priority anymore. Your quiet time that you used to spend reading your Bible and, you know, worshiping God becomes me time. You know, like I'm gonna sit here and watch a movie instead of opening the Bible. Or girls' night out. It's a Saturday, why not? Ultimately, you stop growing in Christ. And so that's just an example of a worldly hearer. And lastly, the last type of hearer that Jesus spoke about in that parable was a receptive hearer. These are people who were referred to as the seeds that fell on good soil. Luke chapter 8, verse 15 reads, But the seed on good soil stands for those with a noble and good heart, who hear the word, retain it, and by persevering produce a good crop. Before God comes down, he's given us all the opportunity and the chance to hear his word. And it's really up to us to decide whether we're gonna be receptive hearers. You know, ones that are not just gonna hear the word, but retain it and live a life that exemplifies his word. So I'm trying and I'm on that track. So I hope that you guys will all join me with it. So thank you.
Let's give Phyllis another hand clap. Okay, now I want to introduce the lovely ladies of the Acts Praise Dancers. Let's give them a hand as they're coming up.
beating in the spirit. I feel a pressing in the spirit.
Hello, everybody. Is this on? Okay. Sorry. So, I can't breathe. So, I'm just going to say this week has been a rough week. We've experienced everything as a praise dance team, from cars breaking down to almost fatal car accidents to infirmities, all of these things. But we had to realize at the end that the greater was coming. So these ladies put everything into this today, just for this moment. So that's really great. And all of the week, you know, I've been tired and I have a cold and stuff, but I just had this backbone all week, and it was my greater. And so without further ado, I introduce to you my boo, my best friend, my Boaz, and my bold man of God, Denzel Goodlow.
My God, what an anointed praise dance. Greater, greater is coming. I just thank God for being here. I just thank God for being in the house of God. I just thank God for our pastor, Andrew Robinson, in absence, for he loves us, you God. You all, pastor doesn't miss church. He loves God and truly loves his people. And I just celebrate our leaders. Thank God for Pastor Robinson. Thank God for Mama Kay Robinson. Greater is coming. Greater is coming. Amen. Oh, that ministered to me. And by saying that, if we can get to the word, can we go to Matthew, the 26th chapter? Amen. Greater. Greater. Now, Mama Kay told me at 6:24 this morning to bring forth the word on today. And just pray for me if I'm the least of them all. All right, we're going to start at the 26th chapter at the 36th verse. And I know you have it by the words of amen, because I really want you guys to get this, read this text here. It's for us. Greater is coming. Amen, my God. I know that you have it by the words of amen. And it reads, then cometh Jesus with them unto a place called Gethsemane, and said unto his disciples, sit ye here while I go and pray yonder. And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, and began to be sorrowful and very heavy. Then said he unto them, my soul is exceedingly sorrowful. This is Jesus. Even unto death. Tarry ye here and watch with me. And he went a little further and fell on his face and prayed, saying, oh, my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt. And it came unto them, the disciples, and findeth them asleep, and said unto Peter, what could ye not watch with me 1 hour? Watch and pray, ye enter not into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. And it says in this verse, he went away again the second time and prayed, saying, oh, my Father, if this may not pass away from me, except I drink it, thou will be done. I want to come to you with a message entitled, Greater is Coming. Greater is Coming. When Jesus went into the Garden of Gethsemane, in Gethsemane, it means oil pressed. If you was listening to the lyrics of that word, Jesus fell in prayer. This is right before he was going to be crucified. Right before he was going to be the savior of the whole entire world. But he was in a garden called Gethsemane, oil press. And when you look at an olive, when you get the oil out of an olive, you have to beat it. You have to press on that olive to get the oil out of it. God wants to get the oil out of our lives. I was thinking about Pastor Robinson, his message. The Lord changed his message, but it all ties in. When hell breaks loose, I know some of us been afflicted in our bodies with certain infirmities. We're going through mishaps, misfortunes, and mistakes that we're dealing with. We're dealing with a lot. And it's hell breaking loose from left and right, and we find ourselves in the Garden of Gethsemane. Don't look at it as that. Jesus, he understands us. He understands us because he showed Christ's humanity. My soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. Tarry ye with me. If this cup can pass with God, if possible. Lord, I want to be in school. If this cup, Lord, I want my bills paid. If this cup, God, my sickness in my body. But if this cup can pass from me. Do we know how the story goes? Jesus' response said, oh, Father, if this cup may not pass away from me, except I drink, thou will be done. Greater is coming. When he was the previous in the Garden of Gethsemane, when he was sold, when he was yet, I mean, now he was betrayed by Judas and going to the cross. And he died for us. He was humiliated, spat upon, beaten, ridiculed. They chose a robber over Christ. And I'm going to throw this in, because in our lives, and we're in our Gethsemane, we're in temptation. When they was in front of the people, Pontius Pilate said, you can choose this robber, this thief, this liar, this robber, Barabbas, or you can choose the God that's going to save your life. And you know what the people did? When I read this in scripture, I actually got this revelation by watching the Passion of Christ. And the Lord dropped this in my spirit. And they chose Barabbas. The Lord said, how many times have you and my people? No, let me speak to me. How many times have you chose Barabbas? God is saying greater is coming. Greater, this was on my spirit. Gethsemane dropped in my spirit. Oil press. God is getting oil out of each and every one of our lives. Oil is being pressed. My family is going through. My auntie is going through a divorce. Spent up to $15,000. My family been in discord. They haven't talked to for years. Talked together in years. But God is restoring my family because I went through the Gethsemane and I said, not my will, but yours be done. Lord, I'm sick in body. I'm weak. I have bills to be paid. I feel alone. But Jesus, not my will, but yours be done. And there's good news. When Jesus is on the cross, they thought it was all over. In the scripture, in the scripture, John 16 and 33, these things have I spoken unto you that in may might be have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. When Jesus gave up the ghost, that was the greatest story ever told. Jesus Christ died on Calvary for you and I. It's for remission of our sins, being justified by his blood, that we'll be able to be delivered, that we'll be able to obtain the greater in our lives because he became the greatest man to ever walk this world. And that is Jesus. I'm talking about Jesus, y'all. The Pharisees couldn't stop him. They couldn't stand him. Pontius Pilate found no fault in him. Herod couldn't kill him. Death couldn't hold him. And the grave couldn't hold him. I'm talking about Jesus. My God, if you understand what season you in, God is going to give you greater. Pray my strength in the Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. We can all stand. We can all stand. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. How many knows greater is coming? Praise God. How many's in this place today that you need a miracle from the Lord today? How many just needs God to stop by and just touch you today?